Hello everybody and welcome to another Anime Thoughts and Opinions video. The disclaimers that used to be listed at the beginning of these videos are now listed at the top of the description down below. Those disclaimers can help to explain for you what type of discussion video I do here in this series. Now, without further ado, this is going to be one hell of an interesting video. Also, keep in mind that there might be like a weird cut somewhere in the video if I only record a little bit now and then have to stop and record the rest later. Just as a fair warning if you notice that. But it is currently 14:05 or 2:05 in the afternoon on the 5th of January, 2023. Okay, now that's a very important date. Of course, I've been saying that in the recent Thoughts and Opinions videos, just in case the video doesn't get uploaded when it's actually made. But this time it's a little bit more significant because the anime we're talking about today, Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, is interesting for various reasons. The main one in regards to me is that this anime has taken me the longest to complete out of any shows I've actually watched thus far. And that's not because of its length or anything, it's more or less just because it took that long for both myself and my co-op partner to actually watch it. I'll get into the dates here in just a second, but it's funny to think about because I have had four shows that have been in progress for quite some time. And after they were started, I basically ended up not continuing them for one reason or another. Each one had a different reason as to why I didn't continue them. And I ended up putting all four of those into the paused section on my analyst, with Fullmetal Alchemist being one of the four. And slowly, we brought Fullmetal Alchemist back, which is great, and it has now been completed, which is even better. So one of those four long-running anime that I haven't been able to finish is now finished. I believe Aki, the person I've been watching it with, said herself when we finished it, "There, I helped you get one of the tumors off of your analyst or whatever, off of your list." Which it was not a tumor, considering its quality, but it looked like a sore thumb on my analyst, just sitting there in progress. And now I've got three others that are still doing that I would like to get rid of at some point as well. But Fullmetal Alchemist was the furthest one back. The other three include Soul Eater, Naruto, and Hunter x Hunter 2011, all three of which have also been in progress. Hunter x Hunter and Naruto both started in, like, I think summer 2020. Soul Eater was, I think, December 2019. And Fullmetal Alchemist was the 7th of October 2019, which means it has taken us over 3 years to finish this show. Now, it wasn't a case of, like, watching an episode or two episodes every other month, you know, for 3 years, where it took us just a long time to watch them. Instead, it was more or less like, we started watching it, then there was nothing for a huge gap of time, and then we came back and finished it all within roughly the same amount of time. Back in October 2019, we watched the first 10 episodes of the show, and then I'm assuming we were going to continue it. To be completely frank, I don't really remember why we didn't continue this show. I just know that by the end of 2019, I was doing a lot of stuff with other people, and by the beginning of 2020, Aki wasn't around herself very much. And so whenever we did get to find time together, we were either playing games, or when we would actually get around to watching anime, we would always end up watching something else. And we were just like, oh, Fullmetal Alchemist is in progress, but that's fine, we'll finish it later for 3 years. Which is why it took us a while to actually get around and finish the show. But we actually only just now continued the show in 2022, which is funny. I believe we started continuing it in September, so Aki and I watched some anime. We watched, like, Vinland Saga in May, I think, and, you know, a whole bunch of other things I was watching this year, too. Most of everything I've watched, I say this year, I gotta remember it is a new year now, 2022. Most of the stuff I've watched in 2022, there was a handful of new things I had never seen, but when I actually cataloged the entire list of all the things I've done last year, it was all mostly rewatches that I've done. tons and tons of rewatches. But in late September, when I managed to peel Aki away from War Thunder for even just a little bit, we continued Fullmetal Alchemist. And we got a very, very good amount of progress into it. We watched like 30 episodes or something like that. And then we didn't do anything in October. We didn't continue the show in November, if I remember correctly. And it wasn't until December that we actually came back and started catching up on the show, only just now having finished it. When did we finish it? The 3rd of January 2023. So 2 days ago, we finished Fullmetal Alchemist, which finally brought it to a close. So I'm happy to say that I still firmly have a rule, that is, I don't want to leave anime just unfinished. I don't like the idea of dropping an anime either. Fullmetal Alchemist was merely a show that was a co-op show, which meant we both need to be together in order to be able to continue it, unless we both agree to just finish it on our own time, which has happened before. Or it just sits there, and I let it sit there. But the other three shows, one of which was a co-op, but is no longer a co-op, that being Soul Eater, the other three shows have completely different reasons as to why I haven't continued them yet. With Hunter x Hunter being related to Patreon at the time, Naruto being related to just my enjoyability of the first five episodes, and Soul Eater also being related to my enjoyability. And that's the only reason I haven't gone back to continue those. Now, Fullmetal Alchemist is not the longest show I have ever seen. It is, I believe, the second longest show I have seen, not counting seasons. Like, obviously, if you say, oh, well, Higurashi or Monogatari has 27,000 seasons in them, you could argue that those are longer. But I'm talking as one complete package, not split up into multiple arcs or seasons that are separate on Analyst. The longest I have seen, I believe, is Cardcaptor Sakura, which is 71 episodes, if I remember correctly. Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood is 64 episodes, making it the second longest anime I have seen. But I just bring that up because I just want to make sure people understand it's not related to the length of the anime that is why it took so long to finish it. It was just a matter of coincidence, basically. So, okay. Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, done by Studio Bones, at the Node, covered in snow, is an action-adventure drama fantasy television show, 64 episodes, they average 20 to 25 minutes per episode, and it started releasing in 2009 and finished in 2010. So we're talking a late 2000s era anime here, or the beginning of the 2010s era, if you will, and this is the first thing I'm gonna say, because I don't really know what the fuck I'm talking about, but to the best of my knowledge, there is a manga, a very popular manga, that this is an adaptation of. Now, there is an alternative adaptation, a 2003 anime, by the name of Fullmetal Alchemist. The differences between the two, I'm sure there's plenty of differences. In fact, I even saw a video on YouTube recommended to me after I finished this. I didn't watch it, of course. It's 5 hours long, about the differences between the 2003 and 2009 anime. But to the best of my simplistic knowledge, is that they both adapt the manga, except the 2003 version of the show was being made before the manga was finished, and thus, by the time it caught up with the manga, it had to go original, and it has its own ending and its own story arcs and stuff by the end. That's at least my understanding of it, while Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood follows it all the way to the end. Of course, I don't even own a single volume of the manga, so I couldn't tell you whether or not that's true. And I've also never seen the 2003 anime. Someday I might watch it just for the sake of having watched it, and we'll talk about it then. Of course, I would love to see the differences between that show and this show. But regardless, so I felt that there was a need to bring that up. I'm trying to see if there's anything else that's important enough to bring up right now. Well, another thing that I'd like to bring up is that Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, this is something that I just want to make sure people understand this as well, Nothing about what I'm about to say I hold against the show, its creator, or its quality, none of that, okay? But it's something that I feel I need to bring up about this show in particular. When I started watching Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, and even for like the two, almost 3 years after we had started watching it, this show was considered the number one anime of all time on not only various websites that catalog every anime they can, but on various lists and articles. You can even still find, to this day, people still considering this to be the best anime ever made. Okay? That's very important, because saying, you know, oh, you know, this anime is one of the most popular of all time is different than saying this is one of the most highly rated of all time. Fullmetal Alchemist was not the most popular anime of all time, it was the highest rated anime of all time. That's saying something. Now, in recent time, that has changed, and Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood is currently, I think, the third highest rated anime ever, instead of the first, as it had basically held for 10 years. The reason I bring this up is, first, because clearly we're talking about something with a legacy here that has a huge following and a lot of devoted fans. The problem I have with that is, it has a lot of devoted fans. Because even before I had ever watched Fullmetal Alchemist, I had heard the stories, and even bear witness to the stories, of the community of this anime going out of their way to flag and burn any show that was coming close in ratings to their precious Fullmetal Alchemist, which ended up destroying that show's chances of being in the top spot where Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood was. They didn't care about the show, what it was, they never had seen it, they didn't care about anything. It was purely to protect the rating that their show had. They didn't want anyone else having that crown, basically. That's a very toxic way to display your own community, and thankfully, because I know people like Aki, I know not everyone in this community is like that, and thus I know that there are plenty of devoted fans to Fullmetal Alchemist out there that aren't pieces of shit, but I wanted to bring it up because of just how huge of an impact this anime has had, that it has people like that in such a large group, and it has worked, these flag campaigns that they've done before. Like I said, I bear witness to them back in 2018 when I started watching anime again. It was happening then. Pretty much every time there was a new season of anime and something was starting to kick off, here comes the Fullmetal Alchemist crowd to fuck it in the ass, basically, right? Now, I didn't actually mark this off on my list, but I'm assuming that Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood is probably a pretty old suggestion. Okay, well, let's see, is it even on my first written list? This is for OG people that have been watching my series since 2018, but I have written lists. Not only do I have a digital anime list where I keep track of all my anime that I'm watching, I also have written lists here. And this one is from 2018, this one that I've got. So it still has shows on here from, like, Made in Abyss is one of the earliest on the list that hasn't been watched yet. Cowboy Bebop, Code Gay Ass. Spy Dandy, etc. So, I'm trying to see. I would have assumed that Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood would be on here somewhere, except I'm not finding it. So, I don't know exactly when this was suggested to me. Here's Hunter x Hunter 2011 on the first list. That's weird. Because with how popular this show was and how highly rated it was, I would have assumed it would have been suggested long ago. I guess I'll have to look on my digital list to try to find where it's at, but because, like I said, I haven't actually crossed it off yet. Oh well, fine. That is what that is. Now, okay, here's the thing about this show, because, holy shit, I'm not really sure I'll be able to do it justice in just summarizing it. Despite there being, like, a three-year gap between us continuing the show, I didn't have any memory issue with the show, with one exception. The 10 episodes that we had watched in the beginning, I remembered, like, most of that when we went to continue the show again in September 2022. But for whatever reason, there's, like, this whole thing that happens in the first 10 episodes that I just had zero memory of, or at least had, like, foggy memory of, something about a church, a revolt, character Rose, some Pope guy. For whatever reason, Aki had to keep reminding me about that, because every time we would see Rose in the show, I'd be like, who the fuck is that? Why are they acting like she was a character? Because she was a character. But I don't know why my memory just kept deleting that part of the first 10 episodes from my brain. It just kept doing that. But okay, next thing I want to mention that's pretty interesting is the story of this. Okay, 64 episodes, right, in this particular anime. And I think, I don't exactly know why the show has the ratings it does, but there's one reason I can say why I certainly gave it a rating as high as I did. Okay, now hopefully I don't get canceled for saying this. I don't think Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood is the best thing I've ever seen, ever. But there's one thing I can say about it that I can't say about many other shows, and that's saying a lot for a show that has 64 episodes, okay? As a majority of the shows I've seen are the 10 to 20 something episodes in length, not 60 fucking episodes. But that is that this entire show has a cohesive story from beginning to end. I don't remember there ever being filler. I don't remember there being, you know, the obligatory beach episode. I don't remember there being any, like, arcs that just didn't matter or go nowhere. I don't remember any of that. It's everything from the minute you start watching until the minute you finish the show. Everything's connected. Everything is moving towards something. It's moving the plot in some direction or the subplot in some direction. It always comes to a head. It always gets tied up by the end. Everything here is so smooth and together. That is why right now, this might change as I still haven't actually made my full entry on Analyst yet for this, but I did give it a legendary 9.0 rating, which legendary ratings go for many things. Usually, legendary ratings are reserved for anime that really hit me in a certain way. You know, while 8-point range ratings are anime that might be fantastic, but didn't really tickle me fancy, basically, just as a personal preference. But the reason I gave this one a legendary rating was because of how cohesive the story was. I was blown away by the fact that there isn't any bullshit here, you know? Maybe I'm forgetting the bullshit, but I don't think there's any bullshit in this show whatsoever. Everything matters that you're watching. And that's regardless of any of the other aspects, you know, if you don't like the animation, or you don't like the art style, or you don't like the color palette, or if you don't like the characters. Everything else just fits together so perfectly. Now, the story of Fullmetal Alchemist, to the best of my knowledge, because this gets brought up a lot, and that's the fact that the creator is actually female. Because a lot of people like to say that women can't make cool stories. Bull fucking shit. If you ever want an example of someone that is a female that is making something that requires a huge brain to create, you look at Fullmetal Alchemist. Easy peasy. Lemon squeezy. I think it was even funny because I don't remember if it was Aki that showed me this or if I ended up seeing it myself on, I don't know if it was on the analyst forums or if it was on like Twitter or something, but someone was bitching about women not being able to make anything, and they're like, nobody could, you know, they brought up Fullmetal Alchemist as an example of something that only men can create, and it was funny because a woman made this, you know, created this original story, which everyone obviously roasted that guy for, but I thought it was it was really fun to read that. So this story is big, it's complicated, but here's the thing, I don't think I can rightfully re-summarize it here. I have a full page of notes. I mean, these notes are tiny and they are crammed together from episode 1 all the way to episode 64. Oh shit, I'm doing this video early. Okay, I'll get to that in just a... Fuck, I forgot. But I was never really lost either when following the show, which again is saying a lot, that because there are plenty of shows that have really complicated stories where I'm watching it and I'm like 10 episodes in, I'm like, oh god, I'm confused. How am I supposed to know this? How am I going to talk about this? I don't understand what's going on. Who the hell's that? What does this mean? Why are they doing those things? You know, and I'm trying to figure all that out, and maybe it's revealed by the end, but maybe it's only revealed by the end, you know, and then you only have a little bit of time to try to piece all the things together. Or, for example, maybe you don't get your answers by the end or something. But while watching Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, I never got lost. And whenever something was like confusing, it was either explained or they gave you enough clues in order to let you piece it together yourself right away. You know, or for example, there might be a mystery that's going on that you know of, and you don't know who's behind it or what's behind it or what, you know, what the government conspiracy is, but you know it exists. And so you're waiting to see that, or you're looking for clues about that. And then, of course, it's revealed and you're like, you know, whatever. Which is super important for a 64 episode long series that I'm not confused for most of it. So while I might not be able to put the whole story into words, I certainly wasn't lost while watching it. I was fully understanding everything that was happening on the screen, unless, of course, there was a character that I didn't remember, like Rose, which is purely a memory issue and not any other issue with the show itself. Now, the reason that I said I am doing this video too early, and I'll bring this up as a disclaimer now for this particular video, but Aki and I actually missed an episode. How we missed it, I only have theories, but I will be watching that episode either on my own or with Aki at some point. I was supposed to do it before I did this video, but I guess I'll have to do it after. We somehow missed episode 49 of the show. I only know this because I record my audio reactions to every anime I watch, and while those aren't uploaded for like years after they were recorded, I can see in the video not only the timestamp of when the video was recorded, but you can actually see in video footage my computer's time clock in the bottom right corner. And we watched episode 48 at like 13:10, so 1:10 in the afternoon. And then we watched episode 50 at 13:16, only 6 minutes later, basically, which meant that we had somehow skipped episode 49. This also made sense because when we were watching the show, I was actually confused about one part because there was no real explanation given. And this is right when the coup in the capital starts. And we also know that characters get left behind in the forest. But I remember just watching the episode and then thinking, wait, there's a coup happening? What's happening? Hello? It already started? I mean, they've been planning it, but when did it start? Apparently it's already started. You know, and how are these, how is Al stuck in this giant dome in the middle of the forest? You know, I guess it was during their fight from two episodes ago. You know, it was a little bit confusing because it felt like it wasn't actually fully connected. Well, now I know why, because episode 49 covers that. And I only know this because I skimmed through episode 49 to make sure it was an episode that we hadn't seen, and it was definitely an episode I have never seen. So at some point I wanted Aki and I to go back and finish, just watch episode 49 for continuity's sake and posterity's sake as well. But I'll have to just bring that up later after the show is, after I've done the video on the show and stuff. So yeah, that's that. I think that gets most of the basic stuff out of the way. There's a lot in this show, way too much, honestly, for my brain to have put down on paper without needing to go the Higurashi route, which is where I use like one full notebook page for one episode. And that's basically, it's in regards, what? Okay, basically that's in regards to just how much goes on in the story and how many characters there are. There's only a few main characters. They say that the rest of the cast is supporting, but you see them so often, I would argue they're basically main characters as well. There's government conspiracies going on. The military is not what they seem to be. There's different countries. There's tons of backstory and lore. There's been wars that have been fought. The show takes place in like the early 1900s or whatever their version of the early 1900s, obviously. Yet you will see military equipment that is not only based on World War I tech, but you will also see World War II inspired tech as well, namely the tanks. And there's a lot of action. Most of it is enjoyable to watch. It can get kind of bloody, it can get kind of violent. There is a lot of religious undertones. There's, for example, you have the homunculi, which are basically these disgusting humanoid beasts that have been created from philosopher's stones, which have been created by the souls of humans, I believe, if I'm not mistaken. basically the whole show is about alchemy. I don't know if you knew this, but the show is called Fullmetal Alchemist, or Alchemist, if you will. And at first, the show starts off with a very simple goal, and that's that our two main characters, our two brothers, Alphonse and Edward, both lose their mother at a very young age due to, I guess, an illness, if I remember correctly. Their father has gone off into the world, and he's, like, never around, you know, usual shit, right? And after losing their mother, they decide to use alchemy to do a big no-no, a very taboo thing, which is to try and bring their mother back with alchemy. Now, equivalent exchange states that in order to gain something, you are meant to sacrifice something of equivalent quality or amount. And so during this exchange, they end up fucking themselves, basically. Edward loses limbs. Al loses his entire body, and he ends up becoming soulbound to a suit of armor. And they don't even bring back their mother in the process. They basically have to come to terms with the fact that they have lost their mother, and instead they bring back a monster, a demon, if you will, that they learn much later in the show that it wasn't even their mother to begin with. It was some different creature entirely. And the whole show basically just becomes, hey, this is an adventure story where we have a brother in a suit of armor that is a suit of armor, and a brother who's missing his arm, and the whole story is about trying to get their bodies back. That's all it is. It's just about getting their bodies back. 64 episodes about just getting their bodies back. And honestly, I would expect nothing less from a shonen anime. Except this isn't just your average anime about adventuring to get your bodies back, because it really quickly kicks off into something way bigger. Like I said, you learn about state alchemists. You learn about the country of Armistice. I don't remember what it's actually called properly. It's basically like Central Europe, I guess you would call it. I could be wrong on that. Surrounded by like Xing, which is basically China. You have the deserts off to the fucking, I don't know, south, north? I don't remember. No, north is some other country that I don't think we really get to see much of. But you learn about this, the military, and that our main characters basically work for them, and that they're very powerful and they care a lot, except there's actually something going on under the hood. And then you learn that, oh, there's a little bit of corruption going on. And then you learn about, oh my god, there's a lot of corruption going on. You learn about the homunculi. You start learning where they come from. You start learning about what their purpose is. You start learning about who created them. The brother's father starts coming up as a more and more interesting character, as there seems to be more to him than meets the eye at first. We learn about a lot of characters along the way. Some characters get killed off. Some characters go missing. We basically learn about the homunculi as main characters themselves. Some of them don't last very long, while others last until basically the end of the show. Some of them become practically main characters by the end of the show as well. There's a lot of like philosophical speak about, you know, what it is to be human, mainly through the eyes of the homunculi, who always look down on humans as inferior beings, but once they meet their demise, they start to realize maybe they were human themselves, or maybe they learned a lot from humans. You know, bringing a lot of character to someone that's not supposed to be a human, although is made out of the souls of humans. There's this whole plot that's revealed, not even by the end, it's like revealed halfway through the frickin' show, about human sacrifices that are meant to be used to create the, I mean, there's a whole bunch of bullshit about how to use alchemy. There's the gate of truth. Everyone's got their own gate, basically, if they are intertwined with this field, that is, that allows them to, I guess, use alchemy. But there's so much going on. And while you have this whole plot about, basically, the government being controlled by some big nasty underground who wants to use the entire fucking country as a sacrifice in order to consume God, you have all these subplots that are going on too. And none of these subplots don't matter. Every single one either matters for a character, you know, like their loyalty missions, if you will, or they actually connect directly to the main plot of the show, but you just won't realize how important that connection is until that particular plot is done, the subplot is finished. You'll see lots of different countries. You learn about like the Ishmaelan War that had happened, which is a country that the place that we focus on ended up going to slaughtering in the past, basically crumbling its culture to nothing. You'll learn about, I mean, fuck. There's a lot of shit that goes on in this show, and it's only 64 episodes. I say only, of course, that's plenty of time to do a lot of stuff, but at the same time, there is so much that happens in this. I would have expected this to be an even longer show with how many characters and how many countries and how many plots there are to go over. There is some pretty screwed up stuff as well. There's a little bit of body horror elements. Of course, I think something that most people seem to like to talk about a lot is Nina from episode 4, who was this little girl that ended up... Well, it's a fucked up scene. Everyone pretty much knows it. Even if you haven't seen the show, you've probably heard of it. But that's a very memorable moment from the first few episodes of the show, and it kind of sets the tone of what you're going to be watching as well. That being said, it's not a super dark anime in the sense that, you know, it's not like fucking depressing or anything. But you do have lots of moments where it does kind of grind to a halt in order to focus on, like, for example, usually whenever homunculi is going to die, we get a pretty drawn out death scene where they're coming to the realization that about death, and they come to the realization that maybe they underestimated humans and stuff. Of course, not every single one gets that scene, but most of them do, and some of them last for ages before they finally perish. Some of them have some of their ends are like redemption arcs, if you will. Some of them survive. I literally can't stress enough that there is so much that happens in this show. And it doesn't move too fast either, at least in my opinion. That's a problem I have with plenty of shows that have too much in them. They move so quickly that you can't keep up with it. And, you know, you end up falling behind and behind as you're trying to remember and trying to keep up with something from 5 episodes ago. They're already introducing stuff that's worth 10 episodes in only one episode of length time, you know? So that doesn't happen here. I never got overwhelmed when watching this show, which is so easy to happen. I find it funny, though, that I posted my teaser back in October on Twitter in 2019 of this show, and I said, thoughts and opinions coming soon, 3 years later. I don't remember if anyone even reacted to that. I thought people would be pretty excited, though, because this is, like I said, a very popular show. But most of my old-school thoughts and opinions viewers aren't around anymore, and it's mainly just some hardcore... viewers that have stuck along, or new viewers, or just people that happen to come across the videos, or people like Aki that for whatever fucking reason watch these shitty ass videos just because. Yes, if you're listening, I know you're listening, okay? Don't be listening to these videos, they're poop. But regardless, so my notes are filled with a shitload of fuck, right? I mean, I could go over every single one of these things. There was a few different moments where I did tear up during the show. I never fully cried while watching Fullmetal Alchemist, but it certainly jerked my tears a few times. The episode 4 with Nina, for example, that was a stage 1 that I had written down in my notes. I had a stage 2A on my cry intensity scale when Hughes, who I jokingly kept calling Markiplier, ends up being killed at one point because I remember him being a pretty cool character. And I believe that there's a moment later on in the show, actually right near the end, where Hohenheim, the brother's father, dies at his wife's grave, and that was pretty sad. And then the granny comes up and she starts crying as well, and that made me cry because, you don't do that to granny, man. But it definitely can jerk your tears quite a bit. And I'm trying to see if there was any other moments along the way that I just don't remember that caused me to tear up. It doesn't look like it. If I do come across one, I guess I'll mention it, but here's another one that I'll mention about why this show is pretty awesome. That's the episode 27 I marked as a recap episode. So long shows like this, they usually have recap episodes that'll take you through, you know, what has already happened. And obviously, this can be useful for people that are watching the show as it's releasing, because it will literally take you months and months and months and months to get the show finished. But for people like Aki and I, who are basically marathoning it mostly in single sittings in a very short period of time, recap episodes are boring and useless because they don't do anything besides show us what we just saw yesterday, you know. But the reason I marked it down is because this show is one of those very rare examples where a recap episode is done right. The recap episode, not only does it show you, you know, recap of old events, but it actually shows it to you through the perspective of Hohenheim, which means we get new scenes, and it also provides extra context to the recap scenes. Meaning, it's not just scenes that we've already seen and then that's it for 20 minutes. You know, wasting your time if you're watching it in a marathon, or heavily disappointing you if you're waiting for a new episode 7 days later only for it to be a recap, and then you have to sit around and wait another 7 days before you actually get to see anything new. We get to have more details of a character that we didn't get much time with up to that point, and we get to learn a little bit more about the scenes that are being recapped specifically. So I appreciate that type of recap episode, and I wish every freaking show did that, because there are plenty of shows of recap episodes that don't do that, that just basically splice together multiple scenes you've already seen, and then that's it. That's all it does. No, not even any new dialogue is provided. Okay, so... Oh, geez, man. These freaking notes... Okay, there are some characters, for example, that I really liked. So, first, I really liked the character Scar, who's introduced right at the beginning of the show, basically. He's a total dickhead. He's just a murdering motherfucker. Except he turns into a total badass by the end of the show. He basically ends up befriending the main characters, or I say befriending, but it's more or less like a mutual understanding that they end up growing. But he ends up fighting alongside our main characters. He ends up putting himself in harm's way, and we end up learning that he's actually crucial to fighting against the full sacrifice that has been planned at the very end of the show as well. So he becomes a main character. He becomes a character that kind of has his own redemption arc, where he's introduced as basically an antagonist, but he becomes a protagonist with good values and morals by the end of the show, at least from the way that I viewed him, that is. There's plenty of other characters like this that have these big turning points throughout the show. Then, of course, you've got some characters that are a little bit more... I don't want to say one-dimensional, because that's like saying this show's like Konosuba, and I don't want to be rude to Fullmetal Alchemist. But there are definitely characters that don't have that much depth to them, that don't have a tragic backstory with, you know, turning points, or, you know, throughout their life. There are characters like, for example, Mr. Armstrong, who just exists to be adorable and strong at the same time, right? You've got his sister, who basically runs Briggs, which is this massive wall complex, I believe in the north, which was one of my favorite parts. You know, and after watching this, I had learned that apparently most people's least favorite part of Fullmetal Alchemist was all of the shit that happens at Briggs and up in the snowy area, because it's slow and takes forever to get through. I was like, holy shit, this stuff's badass. You got a fortress wall. It's one of the only parts in the entire show where you get to see a large-scale battle for about 2 seconds before it's over. You know, I loved everything that happened up there. I love fortresses. I love walls. Combine the two, I'm gonna adore it. I also love snowy mountains. Combine the three, and it's gonna be badass for me. Maybe if I was rewatching the show, you know, 2 or 3 times like I do with Higurashi all the time, I would start to find that part of the show to be a drag. Maybe. I wouldn't know unless I tried rewatching it at some point down the road. So, let's see. I'm trying to look to see if there's anything else that I want to mention here. Oh, pubes. Yeah. The backstory about Father, who is basically the mastermind behind everything. I guess we nicknamed him Pubes, because that's what it is in my notes. We do learn... So all of the homunculi are basically named after sins, right? So you've got pride, envy, gluttony, you know, etc. Greed. And each one of these, completely different character. Every single one. totally different character. Some of them are just badass, like Wrath, for example, who actually turns out to be the king of this country. Other characters have their own internal conflicts, like Greed, who actually gets killed very early on and is reborn, but becomes basically a main character by the end of the show. Envy is another character that's a lot of fun to watch. Now, Envy, okay, I gotta get this out of the way. Envy is voiced by a girl, okay? Sounds like a girl. Almost looks like a girl. But they call the character a him in the show, in the subtitles at the very least. But if you look up her character sheet, her gender is not defined. So I don't really know how to refer to Envy other than an it, and that just sounds rude. But Envy is probably one of the cooler of the homunculi, in my opinion. Mainly just because, well, she's envious. In fact, it's although they confuse envy and jealousy, which really irks me because those are two different words. Very similar, but very different in definition. But I really liked how her story kind of grew and then ended. I liked how by the end she cried when she was going to die because she realized that she's just been jealous of humans, and even though she's been nothing but talking down on them, I really liked how her story came to a close. And I also liked watching her. I liked her transformation, how she turned into that big, giant, green beast. Yes, it was CGI, but it was still really cool to see those scenes. I also love when she is trapped with some of the other characters inside of Gluttony's, like, stomach or whatever, and they have to work together to get out. That was kind of funny. I like that. The character... Who the fuck is the most forgettable one, in my opinion. And I can't even remember her freaking name. What the hell are the other... What the hell are the other sins? Pride's the boy. Wrath is the king. Envy we just talked about. Greed is the dude. Gluttony is the big boy. What the fuck? Why am I drawing a blank on this? Do I need to like look in my notes here? Then there's Sloth as well, who is introduced and then he's kind of there for some of his scenes. But who the fuck is the final one? The woman, the sex lady, the girl that's drawn like boobs. What the hell would that be? Would that be lust? Fucking lust, of course. A booby lady would be lust. Okay. She is my least favorite one of them all. Although she has some great fight scenes, and she's definitely an asshole, but she is definitely probably not up there on my list. I guess it would be between her and Sloth. The only reason Sloth was a little bit more enjoyable for me was because he's like a total dunce, and he's kind of funny to watch. But a lot of these characters die by the end of their arcs. Like, Lust ends up getting killed. Gluttony gets consumed by Pride, if I remember correctly. Envy ends up dying in a fight. Wrath ends up dying in a fight. Wrath lasts basically the longest because he's just so badass. Each one of them has a different ability that they can use. Like, Greed has... I don't remember what Greed's ability really is, outside of the fact that it's like armor, I guess, basically. He can kind of make himself semi-invulnerable. Wrath has this all-seeing eye, basically, that allows him to move at insane speeds while also being able to see the movement of everyone around him. Envy, I think, has the ability to transform and morph into other people, basically sort of like a disguise, if you will, while also having that giant body. I don't even remember what Lust's ability was. Gluttony can eat. Gluttony loves to eat shit. And when Gluttony's stomach opens, you get the fuck out of there, because you don't want to be sucked into that thing and be stuck in an eternal darkness of hell, basically. And Pride, who actually jump scared me, I wrote it down, in episode 42, they are, I believe Hohenheim is walking around in a dark tunnel, an underground tunnel, which had previously been established to have been created by Sloth, who had been digging underground for who knows how long, creating these massive tunnels that are to be used for the huge countrywide human sacrifice. Well, Hohenheim's walking down this dark tunnel, and you can see it's obviously dark, and they're slowly zooming in, and you know something's going to come out of the darkness. It's very clearly built up to have something coming out, and I'm like, oh yeah, well, this is Sloth's tunnel. So Sloth is going to slowly stumble out of the darkness and have a confrontation with Hohenheim. But no, it's fucking Shadow Boy over here, Pride, with his ridiculous fucking shadow ability, comes shooting out of the darkness, and it made me scream because it came out so fast, and I was expecting something, but I wasn't expecting that. Screw this little kid, really. I'm fucking... whatever. Anyways, he gets reborn. It's hilarious when he dies because he turns into, like, this little fetus with a nipple on his forehead. And then he gets reborn later by the... during the end of the show, when we basically get to see an epilogue of the story, that he's now a little boy, and he's being taken care of by his mother. And like I said, there's a huge focus on, you know, what it means to be human. And homunculi all basically have their own kind of confrontation with themselves about, you know, are they themselves humans, or are humans just inferior beings? And it only ever comes to be once they're dead, basically. I wish... well, no. I was about to say, I wish we could have seen more of a certain character, but honestly, I think we saw enough of him. Yeah, we did. We saw plenty of him, so that's fine, whatever. I wish we would have seen Xing. That would have been awesome to see the China, basically. We do get to see multiple characters from there, though, which is great. So let me see if there's anything else that feels important enough to bring up right now. Yeah, by the time you get about halfway through the series, that's when you learn about the promised day, which is basically when the whole country is going to be sacrificed. What's cool, though, is in only the last few episodes of the show, the promised day does come, even though there's, like, a government coup that's happening. You know, there's like... I mean, you'll watch one episode at the end, near the end of the show, and there'll be four different sets of characters in four different areas doing four different things, and it'll flip between them all back and forth, basically, while you're watching these episodes. But it's still very easy to follow. But everyone's doing their own thing, and while one person's doing their thing, another is doing another thing. You know, it makes the whole world feel like it's way more alive than, you know, you're just watching an anime, basically. But the promised day does come, and you do get to see Mr. Father in his pube form come, or as he used to be in a pube form. More on that in just a minute. I'll try to explain what I'm talking about by pubes. But he ends up sacrificing all of these souls. Everyone dies. Fucking everyone dies, literally. And they needed five sacrifices, human sacrifices, very important. It couldn't just be anybody. It had to be very specific people that I think have seen the gate, if you will. I'm pretty sure that's like the rule as to what makes them a human sacrifice. And they all end up being used to eat the whole country. Mr. Father ends up consuming God, what he perceives to be God, that is, and he becomes this ripped young Final Fantasy antagonist, and he looks like he hates everything, right? But that's where Hohenheim comes in, a character that had only ever shown up a few times throughout the show and was established as the Elric brothers' father. And this guy, holy shit, this guy, right? He's had everything planned out. He has been working against Mr. Pube Father forever, and he has been planting seeds since the very beginning. And you can even see this. This is why, for example, basically every time the father attempts to do something dangerous, he gets thwarted by something that Hohenheim is either doing at that moment in time or had already planted for previously. For example, Hohenheim had planted... basically, Hohenheim himself is a homunculi, or is built out of a philosopher's stone. And he has the souls of many people inside of him, and he has planted these souls across the country for many, many years. I don't know how many, like decades, basically, he's been doing this. And maybe even longer than that. And he had planned specifically to do this in order to ruin the whole promised day when the time would finally come. And this is where a lot of people would be like, you know, oh, this comes out of left field, and it's kind of, you know, it's like, ugh, you know, why is this happening? But this doesn't just defeat Father. He is still a very powerful being. He just no longer has tens of thousands, if not millions, of souls. He has instead a limited supply of energy through his Philosopher's Stone, and thus now it is a fight of attrition, where they just need to survive, get this guy to use all of his power, basically, until he drains his Philosopher's Stone, since he no longer has the power of God within him, after it's been thwarted. And also, on top of that, the whole Hohenheim planting seeds, this is actually established at the beginning of the show, except you don't get told about it, but you do see it happening. The whole reason, at least to the best of my understanding, the whole reason why Hohenheim just leaves his family, like he drops them like a dirty rag, is because he's going out into the country to continue his journey of planting these seeds, these souls around the country, in order to prepare for the coming disaster that would happen way in the future. And he's been, that's why every time we see him, we know he's got, there's more to him than you know, than obviously what the show tells us until very late in the show. And when it's revealed, it all makes sense. So it doesn't exactly come out of left field outside of you just didn't notice it. But now that I had seen this moment, I was looking back and I'm like, oh yeah, that's why he left the family. And oh yeah, that's why he's journeying around the countryside. And you know, it now all makes sense. So this was already established, and that's great way to tell stories, because if that was never established and he just dropped this on us at the very end of the show, yeah, it might feel like it's a little bit more of a lazy cop-out of, oh, superpower, you know. But it's not, because there was more thought put into it than that. Unless I'm just interpreting the whole thing wrong and it was just dropped out of nowhere, and the whole thing I'm thinking back on about how this was established just secretly is just him actually going out on an adventure. But I doubt it. I'm pretty sure that's what he was doing when he left his family. So the whole last few episodes of the show, and I see a lot of people agree on this, are fucking awesome, right? Because most of the show is really good, very cohesive, like I said, but it is a bit slow at times. You know, sometimes not a lot really happens, and sometimes a lot of the action scenes aren't super fun to watch, in my opinion. But the ending, the like last four or five episodes or something, when Father is fighting with all of our main characters and our main characters like fighting with Wrath and everyone's in their own little groups and fighting different people, it is non-fucking-stop action. It's clear that most of the budget for the animation went into these last episodes. The explosions have tons of frames to them. The movement of the characters is way smoother and silky, and there's way more stakes here too. For example, right at the end of the show, when Father is in his Final Fantasy antagonist form, he's basically going to consume Edward. And Al, who has already basically screwed himself to protect this little Chinese girl that's adorable, by the way, he decides, because Edward is stuck, he's got a piece of rebar through his only arm and his automail arm, which I didn't talk about automail. It's basically like mechanical arms or mechanical limbs, basically. It's basically mechanical shit, because he lost his arm, obviously, during the taboo thing at the beginning of the show. He has a metal arm. Well, his metal arm has been destroyed, and he is stuck, and he's about to be consumed, and it's over. The whole show is going to end. Now, this is really cool, because Al, in his destroyed suit of armor now, decides to do something he probably shouldn't, and he sacrifices himself to bring back Ed's arm, his real arm, one of the things that the whole show had started about, to get their bodies back. But, obviously, it's a sacrifice. Al gives his own existence, his own soul, in order to bring back Ed's arm. And when he does this, it's a really emotional moment. I could have cried really hard during this scene, but I was glued to the screen during it. Obviously, Ed's having a whole bunch of emotions going through him. He's pissed off. He's angry about Al. He's pissed off at the father pube guy. And he rips himself out of the rebar, and he just goes to fucking town with his bare hands. No alchemy, nothing. He kicks that guy's ass with his bare freaking hands. Total badass scene, right? Now, I would have liked, of course, if Al actually died, because that's the type of person I am. Ending a show like that with a very... Because it was a very noble sacrifice, and at the same time, it was very emotional to see the way that Ed reacts and to see how it allows them to win. But of course, I'm also okay with how it did end. I'm not unsatisfied that, Al didn't stay dead. Edward is able to, with the help of some others, get Al back. And by the end of the show, only the last couple episodes worth, they both come back. Al has his real body back. He's not just a suit of armor, and Edward has his arm. Although there is talk about his leg, I don't know what happened to his leg at the very end, but they talk about how his leg needs maintenance, like he lost his leg. I'm not sure what happened to his leg. Did he, like, lose his leg when they were bringing back Al? I don't know. But the way that Edward brings back Al was actually pretty interesting, and that's that... Usually, again, equivalent exchange, you have to give something of equivalence to bring someone back, or to bring something back, or whatever, to create something, if you will. But what he sacrifices isn't a human life to bring Al back. He actually sacrifices his own gate, which means he will lose the ability to use alchemy from that point forward. And the music that plays, and it's like a revelation, right? It's like nobody ever thought that you could do this, but Edward figured it out, and that's why Mr. Truth, or whatever, this, like, being that talks to you whenever you're in gate place, basically says to Edward, you've won, you figured me out, as if, like, that was the key all along, to sacrifice your gate to bring someone back, or bring something back, you know. Obviously, it has huge repercussions. You no longer can use alchemy, and we even see at the end of the show when Edward's working on a roof and he can't use alchemy. He's like, ah, shucks, basically, right? So, but he brings back his brother in full form, who has to now recover because he's basically a shrill little body. But, yeah, regardless, it was a great ending. And the epilogue's great. You get to see basically almost every single character, what they're doing or what they've been up to. You get to see characters like Mustang, for example, who is a very powerful flame user, flame alchemist. He ends up going blind when he is forced into being a human sacrifice. The thing that is sacrificed is his vision, which is pretty fucked up, but we learn that he might be able to get his vision back, and he decides he wants to help bring back the Ishbalan culture, which is a whole nother plot that I talked about before, as he was actually part of the destruction of that place. But it's a great way to end the show, because not only do you get the ending, and that, you know, it's not like you see the final showdown with Shin, I say, let's get this show on the road. You actually get to see more after that. The show's antagonist gets defeated, then we get to see the closure of that, and then we get a whole nother episode, which is basically the epilogue, where we get to see what happens to everyone afterwards, you know, and some time has passed. And then at the very end, during the credits, you get to see pictures of even further down the road. We learn that the character Winry, who I didn't talk like at all about Winry, because honestly, she's like the only character that doesn't really exist, mainly because she's there at the beginning of the show, and then she shows up like a couple times throughout the rest of the 40 or 50 episodes of the show, and the ending, basically, right? But she's basically Edward's squeeze by the end, right? And it's obviously, they kind of have a little lovey-dovey moment when, at the very end, when Edward's getting on a train to head off on a new adventure. But we do get to see in a picture at the very end of the credits that it looks like we get to see that Chinese girl all grown up, so we know that this is in the future, who, by the way, has a crush on Al, so that implies that Al and Miss China will get... I don't remember her name, I'm sorry. We'll get a family together, but we see Edward and Winry both holding on to a child each, a boy and a girl. It looks like they have had children. So, great way to end the story, basically. Very satisfying and happy. Now, the pube thing I was talking about is actually in reference to Father, who at one point way back in the past was actually like this fuzzy thing in a jar, a flask. Dwarf in the Flask, I think is what they kept calling him, who basically his only wish was to be let out of the flask, and I think this was with Hohenheim's help at the time. He was able to gain a body and thus became this powerful being that started to consume everything, and, well, here we are with Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood, where we get to see all of his plans of consuming everything to consume God. I don't even remember what his goal was. I think he didn't even realize what his goal was until he died. That was when he realized Because you even see him begging for his life. He's basically begging. He's like, all I wanted was to be human, essentially, is what he tries begging for when he gets eaten up for being naughty. But regardless, I liked the ending fight scenes. There's also a lot of, like, soldier fighting, too. There's lots of guns and killing and machine guns and tanks and stuff that happen. Though, one thing I will mention is about the openings. It suffers from the problem I had with Railgun, where the openings, of which there are five openings, by the way, throughout the 64 episodes, but some of the opening songs are really good. For example, I think it's the first opening song is my favorite one, but some of the other ones are also really good too. But it suffers from that problem of, hey, look, you see these openings? Holy shit, they're explosive. There's columns of tanks charging on cities, and oh my god, Briggs has this massive war with all these tanks in the snow and all these soldiers running around, and it never happens. None of the shit you see in the opening actually happens in the show, and I fucking hate that. I mean, I've seen so many anime now that do this. Railgun is the worst example, is the worst offender of an example, because it shows you these massive fights with all these characters, but they never happen. If anything even similar happens, it's super small scale compared to what you see in the opening. Obviously, the opening is meant to get you all pumped up for the show. That's what it is. It's an opening, right? Sometimes it just straight up spoils shit for the show for you, because it's anime. But most of what I have seen, when you watch the opening actually pertains to what happens in the show, or at the very least, pertains to characters or events from the show's past, rather than just being, a super cool extra, basically. This really irks me. It might not seem like a big deal to everyone else, but this irks me a lot. When I see columns of tanks in front of Briggs and a massive showdown happening, and then the only fight you ever get there is a flick of the finger and then everyone's dead, of course I'm going to be a little bit disappointed that we didn't get to see what was teased in the opening. But regardless, I didn't hold that against the show either. It was just something I brought up. If you have watched the show before but skip the endings, and or if you plan to watch it, there are plenty of post-credit scenes. It's possible we may have even missed one, but I think we did pretty good on seeing them. In fact, I think it was a post-credit scene that is the reason we somehow missed episode 49. Because I believe, if I look at my videos of the audio reactions, we finished episode 48, and then there's a separate clip of episode 48's post-credit scene. I believe because we had actually finished episode 48, and then Aki went to episode 49, but I realized there was a post-credit scene. I said, oh wait, there's post-credits. We both came back to 48, watched the post-credits, and then accidentally went to 50, thinking that, forgetting that, you know, because we had, our brain saw 49, and we were just like, oh, well, that's, okay, 50 is next, right? Because I think that's probably how we had accidentally gotten confused about episode 49 and missed it. Regardless, though, lots of stuff to see in the show. I mean, of all of what I talked about, I barely even scratched the surface of what all goes on in the show with every single individual character and interaction that happens. There's definitely more that I could talk about here as well, for example, but honestly, I think I got most of what I wanted to talk about out of the way. Obviously, this show has a great amount of love behind it, not only in its creation, but also for the people that watch it. And it left behind its own legacy, and I have now witnessed it, which is great. It's one of those big, great ones that everyone wants you to see when they talk about anime. Some people, though, even talk about, for example, one thing that I saw on Analyst was, don't watch this as your first anime, because it's so good that you will think everything else after it is crap. I don't think I have that point of view with most of the anime I watched, since I have seen a lot now, since the day that I started watching anime again. I try to watch everything contained in its own little bubble so that I don't let it affect my enjoyment of another show. Unless, of course, those two shows are directly connected. That's a different story. But this show is great. Like I said, the reason I gave it a legendary rating is because of how cohesive the whole story is. How everything just works, as far as I'm concerned. Right? I didn't feel a road bump anywhere or a hole anywhere. If there is one, then I missed it, and I admit that, but I don't think any of that occurred. But in regards to the quality, fantastic. The animation can be a little stiff at times. The CGI is, of course, dated by today's standards, but none of that really gets in the way of my enjoyment either. The art style is, well, very much... It's not even an art style of the late 2000s or to the early 2010s, in my opinion. It looks like an art style that you would see at the beginning of the 2000s. So I'm wondering if the art style is actually based on the manga and is faithful to the manga, which started in the early 2000s, if I remember. I don't know if it was 2000 or 2001 or something when the manga had started. To which I love when they do faithful things like that and try to keep the style of the original creation. But I didn't mind it. And another thing that I wanted to mention is actually there's plenty... It's not listed as a comedy, but there are plenty of comedic moments. But they mainly happen in the first half of the show. There's only a few little quips that happen like in the last half of the show where like a character is like screeching and all that anime art style, like chibi art style or whatever that happens. But when shit gets serious, it's serious, and they focus on that, and that's really important to me. If this was Soul Eater, I'd fucking hate it in the first 7 episodes, like the fact that I have only 7 episodes watched of Soul Eater currently, and it has been sitting there since December 2019, now also 3 years ago. But regardless, that's going to bring this to an end. So that was Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood. And there is other Fullmetal Alchemist stuff that I can now add to the list. Like I said, I'd someday like to see the 2003 series just for the sake of it. There's also some other things. It's like a movie. I don't know anything about all that stuff, but it exists apparently. And as for what's coming up next, there's lots of stuff to do. Don't forget that you can suggest any new anime, manga, or visual novels to me if you want. I'll add every one of them to the list. Some of them might get held off for a while if they're ongoing series or are very long, but I do add everything to my list of their respective types. And as for what's coming up next, Aki and I are already in the progress of almost having finished our next anime, which I've been having a total fucking amount of fun with, so I can't wait to talk about that. But that was Fullmetal Alchemist Brotherhood. If you've seen it and love it or hate it, feel free to share your own opinions on it in the comment section down below, and I will see you guys in the next anime thoughts and opinions video. Goodbye.